It's Professor Dave. Let's solve trigonometric equations.
He knows a lot about all kinds of stuff, Professor Dave explains.
There are lots of problems we can solve using trigonometry, so let's see what some examples might be. The first thing we could do is find things like angles of elevation. Let's say that there is a building that is 30 meters tall, and it casts a shadow that is 16 meters long. What is the angle of elevation of the sun to the nearest degree? Well, we can set up a diagram, and we quickly see that we have a triangle with both legs of known length. Which trig function do we know that relates the sides to this angle? That would be tangent, which is equal to opposite over adjacent. In this case, tangent theta equals 30 over 16, or 15 over 8. To solve for theta, we just need to find the inverse tangent of 15 over 8. We can plug that into our calculators, making sure we are in degree mode, and we should get just a hair under 62 degrees. We can do all kinds of useful things of this nature using trig functions. If we know how far away some building is, we can instantly know how tall it is just by measuring the angle of elevation required for your line of sight to coincide with the top of the building. If this distance is 100 meters and this angle is 55.3 degrees, then we can take the tangent of the angle, which will be equal to this height over 100, then multiply by 100, and we get around 144 meters. So these are indeed powerful techniques. But beyond this, we need to be able to solve trigonometric equations, meaning we need to be able to look at equations with trig functions in them and solve for x. Say we have 4 sine x plus 1 equals 2 sine x plus 2. First, we need to combine like terms, so let's subtract 2 sine x, as well as 1. That gives us 2 sine x equals 1. Divide by 2, and sine x equals 1/2. Now, to solve for x, we can definitely take the inverse sine of 1/2, or we can picture the unit circle and recall that pi over 6 has a sine value of 1/2. But the only problem is that this is not the only solution to this equation. The sine of 5/6 pi also gives 1/2. Not only that, but either of these values plus any multiple of 2 pi will also be a solution, because starting at 1/6 pi, if we go all the way around to get here again, which would be 13/6 pi, that will also be a solution. Therefore, the way we express this solution will be 1/6 pi plus 2n pi and 5/6 pi plus 2n pi. With these, n can be any integer, so if it's 1, this is 2 pi. If it's 2, we get 4 pi. Whatever it is, it represents some number of times going around the unit circle to get back to the same spot, and therefore another solution to the equation. In this way, just as algebraic equations often have 0, 1, or multiple solutions, trigonometric equations often have multiple or even infinitely many solutions. Things get a little more complicated when we start manipulating the trig functions. Say we want to solve tangent 3x equals 1. Well, what angle gives us a tangent of 1? That would be quarter pi, because root 2 over 2 divided by root 2 over 2 gives us 1. That means that 3x equals quarter pi. But is it just quarter pi? If we go to the other side, negative root 2 over 2 divided by negative root 2 over 2 also gives us 1 for the tangent, so 5/4 pi works as well. That means that 3x equals quarter pi plus n pi. Now, to solve for x, we divide both sides by 3. That leaves us with pi over 12 plus n pi over 3. Trigonometric equations get much more complicated than this. We can even see them in quadratic form. Take something like 2 cosine squared x minus 3 cosine x plus 1 equals 0. And we are just looking for answers in the interval from 0 to 2 pi. It may look different than your typical polynomial, but we can factor this into binomials just like we normally would. We know we will need 2 cosine x here and cosine x here. Then from there, the factors of 1 are either 1 and 1 or negative 1 and negative 1. Since this cosine term is negative, let's try the negatives, and that does indeed work out, since we get minus 1 cosine here and minus 2 cosine there. Now, as we know, each of these binomials can be set equal to 0, giving us 2 cosine x equals 1, or cosine x equals 1 half, and then cosine x equals 1. Well, where does cosine equal 1 half? That would be at 1 third pi and 5 thirds pi. Where does cosine equal 1? At 0. So the solutions are 0, 1 third pi, and 5 thirds pi. There are other situations where we will have to factor in a different way. Take sine x plus 2 sine x cosine x, solving for the interval from 0 to 2 pi. These two terms have sine x in common, so let's factor it out. That leaves us with sine x times the quantity 1 plus 2 cosine x. Now, if sine x is 0, this whole side is 0. So 0 and pi are solutions, because the sine of 0 and the sine of pi both equal 0. Then for this one, 2 cosine x equals negative 1, and cosine x equals negative 1 half. That means that 2 thirds pi and 4 thirds pi are also solutions. Other strategies involve using trigonometric identities. If we have an expression with sine squared terms and cosine squared terms, we can change one of them to the other using this identity. There are too many identities to do examples for each, and as we have already learned the identities, we can just remind ourselves that all of these strategies are at our disposal. I think we get the idea, so let's check comprehension. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.